Hey there, several years ago we did a video on potentiometers, covering some of the theory, and today I'd like to expand on potentiometers and do a few practical applications with them. I've worked with our Friend of CircuitBread CUI devices for these examples, and am both grateful for their support and recommend checking out their blog about potentiometers on CUIdevices.com. So let's start with a quick recap of what potentiometers are and how they work before we jump into using them to show how to control music volume, and then another example of how to control the speed of a DC motor. But first, let's go back to the basics. We need to remember that resistance is dependent on three factors. First is resistivity, or the inherent characteristic of a material to resist the flow of electricity. This is represented in equations by the Greek letter rho, which looks a lot like a P. Second is the cross-sectional area of the material. The bigger the area, the greater the amount of current that can flow through the material. And finally, there's the length of the material under consideration. The longer the object is, the more distance the electrons have to flow through that specific resistivity, increasing the overall resistance. The simple equation to calculate resistance is length times rho divided by area. So why did I need to go into such detail about calculating resistance? Because this is exactly the principle used by potentiometers. While the resistivity is constant, and most potentiometers also keep the area constant, we can change the length of the resistor by sliding a contact across a uniform resistance element. This lengthens or shortens the path of the current from one of the leads through the contact, changing the overall resistance. Most potentiometers are three-terminal devices, which means that the resistance between the two ends of the potentiometer remains the same, but the resistance between the middle terminal, called the wiper or output, and the other two terminals will change as the wiper is moved. And with a properly set up circuit, this will also determine the voltage seen by the wiper. Before jumping into the examples, I will also remind you about the difference between linear and logarithmic potentiometers. Linear pots are straightforward in that if it's at the halfway position, the output is at the halfway point. For example, if your output varies from 0 to 10 volts, as you rotate the shaft, then at 30% of the rotation, you'll have 3 volts at the output. 65% of the rotation will be about 6.5 volts. Now, for logarithmic, the shape of the curve is very different. When you turn the shaft to 10%, you're looking at a 9-volt output. So far, that just seems inverted. But then once you get to 40% of the shaft rotation, your voltage output is 2 volts. At 70%, you're getting below a half volt on the output. To make things more interesting, there are also reverse logarithmic potentiometers that look basically the same as a logarithmic potentiometer, but inverted. These logarithmic pots are excellent for audio and visual applications, as both our hearing and our vision are logarithmic. It's exactly this type of logarithmic application I'm going to show with a music volume circuit, but then I'll use a linear potentiometer for the motor example. These are two very straightforward circuits, but show some of the powerful ways that a potentiometer can be utilized. The music volume application is the easiest way to use a potentiometer, and as mentioned, we'll use a logarithmic version from CUI devices. In this case, we take the audio signal and run it through the potentiometer directly to the ground. We hook the speaker to the wiper of the potentiometer. Now, as we move the potentiometer back and forth, we're diverting a different amount of the signal from ground through the speaker instead. Now, this isn't the most powerful setup in the world, but you can hear the difference as I turn this up and down. Potentiometers are very rarely used to control more than a watt of power directly, since they have to dissipate the input power and would get unacceptably hot. Actually, this particular potentiometer can only handle an eighth of a watt of power. But this is okay, as the point of a potentiometer is instead to adjust analog signals used by other components to control power. We see that the challenge with this audio example is that there is no amplification, so it is only able to drive the speaker as much as the source is capable of. An even bigger issue is that any excess power coming from the source is being dissipated in the potentiometer itself. As mentioned before, this is a bad design, as the potentiometers are not designed to handle much power. Instead, as we'll show in this DC motor control example, you'll want to use some sort of transistor controlled by a low-level signal from the potentiometer. In this circuit, we have a power supply, DC motor, and a linear potentiometer from CUI devices. But more importantly, we have a transistor. We have the output of the potentiometer, whose voltage we control, connected to the gate of our transistor. I'm using a MOSFET, but this concept would work with a BJT as well. As I increase the voltage that appears on the gate of the MOSFET, it opens the drain to source channel and increases the amount of voltage seen by the DC motor. Yet the amount of current that flows through the potentiometer never changes from the small amount of current that is always flowing through, meaning that the potentiometer is not at risk of getting burned out. You can see that by implementing this very simple circuit, you can expand the uses of a potentiometer significantly. I'll let you think of some applications that you may be interested in, but the high-level places you can use this circuit are in audio, video, robotics, general embedded systems, and more. So as we wrap this up, I just want to take a moment to again thank our friend of CircuitBread, CUI Devices, who made this tutorial possible. I recommend you go learn more about them, their product line, and browse their excellent written and video educational resources as well. If you found this video useful, please give it a like, subscribe to our channel, and we will catch you in the next one. Take care. Hey, we hope you enjoyed the video. Did you know that CircuitBread.com has more than tutorials? One of the other many things that we have are several excellent open source textbooks that benefit from our search tools, highlighting, super fast page changes, and keyboard-friendly navigation. Go check them out.